All right, this week I'm going to finish off the book of Ephesians, and I think it's an interesting chapter. And if you're not familiar with the armor of God, it'd be a good reminder to you like what these pieces of the armor represent. I think it's always very interesting how these pieces of the armor represent protecting physical things and how they relate to the spiritual. So it's a great thing. So Ephesians chapter 6, we'll just jump straight into it. So there's three sections in Ephesians chapter 6. And really, you know, there's a lot of practical, like we talked about in Ephesians 4, Ephesians 5, Ephesians 6, there's a lot of practical application and practical instruction, but you can see that it follows these themes. If you remember in Ephesians 4, it was about unity, right? Ephesians 5 is about like living wisely in an ungodly world. And the theme that you sort of see, well, I sort of see throughout Ephesians 6 is, you know, godly versus ungodly authority, right? So this is why you can see, why is it addressing children and parents, servants as masters? Because it's talking about authority that you can see throughout this chapter. So the first section I want to talk about is godly authority. This is the sort of structure that God has set up in the family, in the workplace, and even, you know, in the government. He has set up an authority structure as well, that men would rule over others in the sense of, you know, setting rules and making sure those rules are enforced. So let's go into Ephesians 6, verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Now, some parents misunderstand this, and sometimes Christian parents will use this against their children. Now, it does say here, children, obey your parents in the Lord, but that doesn't mean adults obey your parents in the Lord. So there is a time when children become adults, right? And they have to make decisions for themselves. So sometimes parents think that they can just command their adult children to do whatever they want. And sometimes, you know, adult children who say, no, mom, dad, I'm not going to do that, because they've made different choices in their life. They might say, well, you know, doesn't the Bible say to obey your parents? So this is not just like a blanket statement for the rest of your life that you do whatever your parents tell you to do, because obviously you become an adult one day. But verse 2, it says, honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. So, you know, we always respect our parents, and we should may decline a command from our parents respectfully. But there does come a point, and, you know, the Bible doesn't necessarily set that age. So different people may have different convictions about what that age is. But, you know, the Bible tends to set adulthood at about 20 years and up. So I guess when 20, 21 in America, you know, makes kind of sense. 20 years and up is when they started counting children as men. But, you know, maybe once they leave the house, they're no longer dependent on the parents. So, you know, maybe you're still living at home, you're still dependent on your parents, still living in the house. Obviously, there's some authority there. If somebody's paying your way, right, providing you shelter, providing you food, providing you all these things that you do as they wish in their house. So there's that sort of principle as well. So honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. So what is that referring to? So if you go back to Exodus 20, where the 10 commandments were given, so this is where we get the commandment to honor thy father and thy mother. When God gives the commandment, honor thy father and thy mother, he also says that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. So I'm not entirely sure whether there is some physical connection with, you know, being respectful to your parents, honoring your parents, that has some sort of physical mechanism to make you live longer physically. Or, you know, the obvious one is that God will bless those who honor their father and their mother with longevity of life, right? That their days may be long upon the earth. So that's what he's referring to there in Ephesians 6. It's the first commandment with promise. So it was a commandment that was actually given that had a specific promise to it. That it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. So it's saying here, long, thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Now, to honor your father and your mother, it is not only about respect and reverence, right? When you honor something, you reverence them, you respect them, but that's not just what the Bible is talking about, right? The Bible, when it talks about honoring your father and your mother, it is also making sure that when they are older and they are unable to take care of themselves, that you take care of them, that you provide things for them, right? They provided for you when you were young and you grew up, and then if they need help when they're older, children, the Bible actually teaches that children have an obligation to their parents to make sure that they are taken care of. So it's not just something that you do and it's a favor that you do your parents, it's actually it's a commandment, right? So honoring your father and mother, that's what it means. Like, how do you give them respect and reverence is one way, is when they're older, that you take care of them. Look at what Jesus says in Matthew 15:4. For God commanded, saying, honor thy father and mother. And look, and Old Testament verses, commandments, had some serious penalties for cursing your father and mother, right? So this is not just disobeying your father and mother. This is actually wishing ill upon them, right? And he that curseth father or mother, let him die the death. So you can see here, you know, in the Old Testament, there were laws governing the family. And this is why you had fornication laws and things like that, because it was very important to build a stable society, that the family was respected, that structure. But ye say, verse 5, look at this, whosoever shall say to his father or his mother, it is a gift by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, and honor not his father or his mother, he shall be free. So what are they saying? So they're saying they're honoring their father and mother, but whenever they do something for their father and mother monetarily, they're saying, hey, this is a gift that I'm doing for you. I'm actually doing something extra. And he's saying, no, this is included in honoring your mother and your father. If you think it's a gift, you're not honoring them in the sense that you are actually expected. It's an obligation for you to do this. It's not a gift. It's not something you're doing on top of what you're commanded to do. And honor not his father or his mother, he shall be free. Thus have you made the commandment of God of none effect by your tradition. So you can see there that there is an expectation for younger. And even so, it says here, like in 1 Timothy 5, honor widows that are widows indeed. But if any widow have children or nephews, let them learn first to show piety at home and to requite their parents, for that is good and acceptable before God. So even in the Bible, it seems as though that even aunties are meant to be taking care of nephews as well. So older women who are widows here, right? So you, first of all, it's always husband and it's your children. But it seems here that if a auntie has been left widowed without any children, that then the nephews should take care of a widowed auntie. Right? So that's interesting there too. So honor widows that are widows indeed. This is not just talking about respecting widows, right? It's about actually the church providing for them, or the family providing for them when they need help. Right? So it's more than just respect. Let's continue. Ephesians 6:4. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So a couple of things here. So why, first of all, fathers and children? So remember, the theme going through this chapter is like godly authority, right? Versus ungodly authority. So one reason why I think fathers is mentioned here is because the father is the head of the home. Right, so you have the children, and then you have the father being the head of the home. So you have God addressing the followers, the people that submit to the leadership, and then you have the leader within the home and addressing him. Right? And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So you see, fathers are responsible for the spiritual well-being of their home, like we saw last week in Ephesians 5, and bringing up their children. Look at this. In the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So sometimes people think nurture is for moms, admonition for dad. You know, wait till your dad gets home. Dad's always the one telling the kids off. Dad's the strict one, right? So yes, the admonition is there, but you have to remember as well that fathers are also responsible for being nurturing, right? So that means it is possible to be hard on your children and be strict, but also teach them how to love as well, and how to be loved, right? So just like Jesus Christ is not only love, right? Jesus Christ is not only wrath, right? Though he has that as well, right? He has punishment as well, but he's also nurturing. He also cares. He also edifies, right? He encourages as well as tells off, right, and punishes. Okay, so fathers have both those responsibilities. Colossians 3:20, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. So it's interesting, different take here, that if you do not raise your children the right way, what are they going to be discouraged by? You know, that's an interesting thought there. You know, what are they discouraged? You know, probably discouraged from following God, you know, taking you seriously. Discouraged from doing this. You see? So, you know, how you raise your children. It's not, you can't just blame, like, you know, leaders can't just blame followers. And the same token, followers can't just blame leaders. Remember how you always have to apply verses to yourself? So, you know, you can be a follower even without a good leader, but you have to be a good leader even without good followers, right? Provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. All right, let's continue. Verse 5. So now we looked at children, parents, so fathers, children, and now we're looking at the work relationship, servants and masters. Servants, be obedient to them that are your masters according to the flesh. So when you see servants in the Bible, in our day and age, you can kind of think of employees. They're similar, not exactly the same, but similar, right? Servants, be obedient to them that are your masters. So what are masters? Like bosses, managers, team leaders. Those are in authority over you at work, right? According to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in singleness of your heart as unto Christ. So you see there that the Bible is encouraging, or is telling servants that you should work your job as though you are serving the Lord Jesus Christ. Not with eye service as men pleases. What does that mean? You don't just do your job because how you look in front of other people, right? The attitude that a Christian should have when they work their job is that they are working for the Lord. And the Lord is always looking, right? The Lord sees everything. So that's why you don't just work when men see you, right? When the boss is off the job and you're slacking around, you know? The boss is not on the job site and then everyone's just slacking around, you know, I don't know how all these tradies have like all this time to make TikTok videos. You know, you go through the shorts and these tradies have all this time, these nurses have all this time to make all these videos. I mean, don't they have work to do? But they're making all these videos, but maybe when the boss is on the job, then they get to work. So not with eye service as men pleases, but as servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with goodwill doing service, as to the Lord and not to men. So look, he's just spent three verses there. So it must be like a big problem with servants, because it's easy for servants to get slack, right? Even today, you know, servants, or we say employees, they have this entitlement mentality, right? That they're entitled to a job, right? And the boss just owes them a job, right? No, he's saying here, you servants should be working hard, because even today with this entitlement mentality, a lot of people are slack on the job, right? Servants, so it's serving Christ. Look, it's three verses, verse 5. As unto Christ. Verse 6, servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. Verse 7, as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond or free. So, two main thoughts here, I think, in these couple of verses. One is, sometimes you get this thought like, you know, there's spiritual activity and then there's secular activity. And I know for myself, you know, when I wanted to do more for the Lord, I always thought, well, you know what? If I didn't work so much, I'd have more time to do like spiritual things and, you know, not have to go to work. But then what changed my perspective here as a young man is when I realized, hey, doing your job well is a service to the Lord. You know, when you go to work and you work hard and you do your job well, you know, you will have not only a better attitude when you work, you do a better job, and it is actually something spiritual, like working hard and doing your job well, serving the Lord. See, so it's not only in the context of like church and religious organization where you go, well, they're serving the Lord and I'm working a secular job. No, you could actually serve the Lord by doing your job righteously and doing it like you're doing it to God. And that last verse in verse 8 is saying, hey, that's the perspective you should have. Where if you're serving God, God's going to reward you. You know, not everyone is in a situation where they're getting compensated the way they ought to, right? Or maybe you do a job, you got ripped off, you know? But the Bible's saying here, but that doesn't mean you don't do the job like you're doing the job serving the Lord. Because why? God will make things right. He will right the wrongs, whether in this life or whether in the next. So you can have comfort knowing that you just serve the Lord, doing the right thing, and God will make things right. So then we go on. This is in Colossians 3. This is the parallel passage. Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleases, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. So you see there, like God, you know, you should have some fear of God if you slack off on the job, right? When you don't work the way you should, there should be some fear of God there. And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and not unto men. So this even extends even past the job, right? This is saying, hey, whatever you do, do it heartily. What does that mean? With your whole heart, you know, like you really mean it, like sincerely, as to the Lord and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. But he that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong which he hath done, and there is no respect of persons. Right? So he's saying, God, you know, has no respect of persons. He just rewards according to what people have done. And, you know, we trust that, if we know that, then we will work our hardest. We don't have to compare ourselves to others. We just do the best we can with what we've got. So the other side of that equation in this authority structure that God has ordained, right, is you have the bosses. So he addresses the servants, and now he addresses the masters. And ye masters, do the same things unto them, forbearing, threatening, knowing that your master also is in heaven. So what does he mean by do the same things unto them? Meaning serve, be a boss, like you are working for the Lord Jesus Christ, right? So it's not only the employee works, like he's working for Jesus Christ, but the boss rules and governs his business or his team like he has a higher boss, because everyone has the higher boss, the Lord Jesus Christ. Forbearing, threatening, knowing that your master also is in heaven, neither is there respect of persons with him. So like God does not have respect of persons, bosses should also not play favoritism within the workplace, right? That's what he's saying there. Colossians 4, masters, give unto your servants that which is just and equal. So you see, our bosses will be held accountable to God for how they treat their workers. Give unto your servants that which is just and equal, knowing that ye also have a master in heaven. So you see how everybody is accountable to God. In the family, the husband is to Christ, right? The boss is to God as well, right? So even though you think, you know, you are the boss, well, you've got a boss as well. That just makes you accountable to the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? So first part of the chapter in Ephesians 6 is talking about these authority structures that we see in society. The family, and then we also see in the workplace. Then he goes on, and you see in the same context, now he's talking about withstanding or standing against ungodly authority. Right? So this is why this passage here, when it talks about the armor of God, fighting this spiritual war, it's still in that same context of authority, right? So there's godly authority. Now we go into ungodly authority. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. So the devil's the god of this world. Right? He's the prince of the power of the air, right? That we stand against. See the theme running through this chapter? For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. So it's not a physical war. Now, on that point, see, I'm not against physical war. See, there are some people that are so against physical war that they believe that even when your country is attacked, that you should not participate in defending your country, right? Which I don't think is correct. You know, so we don't fight a spiritual battle in the sense that we are not trying to build a kingdom physically, offensively. Right? This is what it means, like we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, right? So, but when it comes to actual physical war, I mean, there's nothing wrong with a country defending itself, defending its property, defending its people. So there is a place for war, but it's generally defensive. You know, the idea that, see, nations, they are offensive as well, as they try to build empires. You know, I don't know who's right with Ukraine and Russia. You know, I don't look into it that deeply. But obviously there's a battle there over that land. You know, somebody's trying to increase their kingdom, another one's trying to defend, or, you know, maybe the other way around. You know, maybe NATO's trying to increase their kingdom and imposing their will onto Russia. But when we see here, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. See, we are not offensive physically. We're not trying to build a physical kingdom and try and take over land and all that sort of stuff to build up a Christian kingdom. Jesus Christ is going to do that one day. He will come, and it is offensive. He will rule with a rod of iron, right? And he will rule from, I believe, Jerusalem. You know, it's going to be like the capital city of the world when he comes and rules and reigns. But spiritually, we are offensive, right? Spiritually, we should be on the attack. You know, Christians that have the mindset of, you know, they just want to live away from society and just, like, you know, live at peace, that's not our job. You know, as soldiers of Jesus Christ in this world, our job is not to just be recluse from society and just be left to live in peace, right? Because why? We want to reach society. We need to go into all the world and preach the gospel. We need to be offensive. We need to get in there. We need to stand against bad ideas. We need to promote the right ideas. So you see how there's an offense in Christianity. It's not just defensive. But physically, it's not offensive, right? It's just defensive. So we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. You see the authority here? Principalities against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So you see there, that theme of ungodly authority. That's what we're standing against, right? And we have an obligation to stand against. Not only to stand against it, but to go on the offense, to try and gain ground. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. Look at this. And having done all, to stand. You see, so this is a spiritual fight. It's a fight of words. You know, and as we go through the armor of God, there are obviously differing degrees to which you can wear this armor. So it's not just enough to just do the bare minimum, right? He's saying here that you put on the armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And look at this. And having done all to stand. See, when you put on the armor of God, you put them on to the greatest degree you can so you can be the most effective soldier you can. So then when we go on the offense, we can gain the most ground that we can. See, so it's not just, yeah, I do a bit of that, it's good enough. No, it's having done all to stand. Right? So, we resist the power. Right? So, that means, see, when people misuse Romans 13, see, Romans 13 says, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. So we need to understand, you know, God has, his will is that there is structure in the home, structure in church, structure in the workplace, structure in society. But what that does not mean is that everyone that is in power is put there by God. So you see how what God is saying here, there are powers. And powers are ordained. I believe what it's saying here is there's structure. God always wants authority. He doesn't want anarchy. He doesn't want a free-for-all. There's always authority in every area of life. But not everyone who takes up those roles are necessarily put there by God. Because if everyone in authority was put there by God, then what are the ones we're resisting? Right? So if it shows here that there are powers in high places, in the darkness of his world, that we must resist against, that means that there are some powers in the world that are not put there by God. You see what I'm saying? So we don't just blindly follow any authority, any direction, any law, right? Because we need to judge them in light of this, right? Is it of God? Is it according to God's will? Is it a righteous thing to do or not? You know, am I sinning when I keep this law? So I won't go too far into that, but I want to show you that. That, you know, Romans 13 says, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. It does not say, let every soul be subject unto their current government, right? So sometimes current governments become corrupt, right? And they do not follow the highest laws in the land, which could be the constitution if there's a rule of law in that country. But even the constitution to a Christian is not higher than what? God, God's laws. So there's always a hierarchy of authority, and we're always subject to the higher powers. So that's something that we have to sort of wisely decide when we decide what we obey in this world, is where that authority lies, and we always do the will of the highest authority, and obviously that top one is the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's go through quickly this armor, so you know what this armor represents. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth. So when it says your loins girt about with truth, this is talking about a belt of truth. Now, why is truth pictured as a belt? Well, what does a belt do? Right? A belt keeps your pants up. When you gird yourself, is when you wrap things around to keep you know, your nakedness from being shown as you fight in battle. So this is what the belt represents. It's a belt of truth, because when you are hiding your nakedness, it stops you from being ashamed. Right? This is why there's a link here between being knowing truth and being ashamed. Look at Revelation 3:18. This shows that the shame of your nakedness. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness, see there, do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest appear. It's like when God told Isaiah, you know, to 3 years to walk with your buttocks uncovered, your nakedness shown, right? He was showing, he's bringing shame on Isaiah to show the shame that he was going to bring on his people. Kind of feel sorry for Isaiah, you know, that he had to do that for 3 years as this picture that he was going to judge and bring shame on the nation. But you can see their nakedness being likened to, you know, shame. So when your loins are girt about with truth, when you know truth, then you're not ashamed. 2 Timothy 2:15, look at this. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And it does bring you shame. You know, like when you don't know what you're talking about, you've been a Christian for a long time, you don't know your Bible, you get into an argument or a conversation with somebody, you can't defend it, you feel a little bit ashamed. You know, imagine if somebody asked you, like, how do you be saved? And you don't know how to explain it to them? Oh, that's a shameful thing. You know, that's like your spiritual nakedness being shown, that you're not girded up with truth, right? So have your loins girt about with truth. So I love how these different pieces of the armor, they just like relate to something physical, and there's a spiritual truth there. Having on the breastplate of righteousness. So what does a breastplate protect? It protects your chest. So you can see here that righteousness, what is that protecting? That is protecting your heart. Is your heart right with God? And when you think of the heart, it's what you love, what you're passionate about. You know, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So how does righteousness defend your heart? Because when you're righteous, you're obeying the commandments of God, you have the love of God, then you are not loving the things of the world. Isn't that right? 1 John 2:15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. So you know, this worldliness, this sinfulness, this is anti-righteousness, isn't it? See, so when you're righteous, you're not doing these things. You don't have a love for the world. You're going to have a love for God. Your heart's going to be right. Lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. You see here in Revelation 2, see when your love goes cold, how do you rekindle that love? Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. You see, when your love grows cold, your heart, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent. Look at this, and do the first works. See, it's righteousness. It's doing good works will get your heart right with God. Or else I will come unto thee quickly and remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. You know, you think that, you know, the way you live doesn't affect your spiritual life. But, you know, I've seen it so many times where people, they get away from God, you know, they start caring less about the things of God, not going to church consistently, not reading their Bible anymore, not trying to share the gospel, not going soul winning. And they think, no, I'll just be fine. But then you see the love of God in their life start to drift off. You know, and they start becoming more inconsistent. They start forgetting the things that they once knew, right? The stands that they take in their life start to become weaker, right? They start to compromise, right? And then sin starts to creep back into life. They start going back into their old ways. So how do you protect your heart? You know, got to do good works, righteous living, right? And that'll protect your heart. Ephesians 6:15, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. This is great. So the gospel of peace is likened unto boots in this armor of God. And why is that? Because when you're shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, you put on boots to travel, to go, right? And so the gospel needs to be taken to people. You're not expecting people to come to you. So that's why this idea in evangelism, that I just live my life and just wait for people to ask me about how to be saved. You know, I just tell them, I will go to church or I'm a Christian. Hopefully they'll ask me how to be saved. This is contrary to God's will. God wants us to go to people, right? We're on the offense. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Mark 16:15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. So this is why it is boots of the gospel, because we go and we preach. We go to them. Right? It's not good enough just to wait and expect them to come to us. That's why we're going to go soul winning this afternoon. Right? Because we're going to go to them. They're in their houses. We're going to go find some people to talk to. Right? Find people who want to know about how to be saved. And we're going to bring the gospel to them. We're not going to expect them to come and grace the doors of this building. Right? Ephesians 6:16. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. So what I love about this is, so why is faith a shield? Because generally a shield is there to protect you on a side that you're not looking, right? So it's to defend you from the unseen. So faith is that shield where you're maybe fighting on this side and you're being defended by the things that you can't see. So not only is faith the shield, and faith is something you can't see, but if you think about it, it's what is it protecting you from? It's protecting you from all the fiery darts of the wicked. So something interesting about fiery darts of the wicked is when a dart comes your way, you see the dart, but you may not know the source of the dart. So you see how, like, the faith of the shield is like the faith is unseen. It's like that spiritual realm, and it's actually defending you from spiritual attacks. Right? Things that where you don't know, you can't see the source of it, right? But it comes at you and you know when it hits, right? But you don't necessarily know where it's come from. And bad doctrine, bad thoughts in the world, discouragement, it's like that, right? You may not know where it comes from, but it appears. But the shield of faith keeps you on the right path. Now, faith is not just anything. It's not just believing anything. You know, a lot of like movies these days, when they try and teach, you know, their philosophies of the world, right? Obviously anti-Christian philosophy. And it sounds good. You know, maybe Christians will get caught up because they hear faith, faith, believe, believe. And then this movie is just like, just believe, believe. But believe in what? You know, it's not just believing in anything. It's not believing in yourself. It's not believing in the world's philosophies. It's believing in God, right? Psalm 18:30, as for God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord is tried. He is a buckler. What's a buckler? It's a shield, right? If any of you have any played any sort of like medieval games, you'll know that buckler. It's like one of the first shields you probably find, you know, when you're killing all those monsters. To all that trust in him. So you see how it's a shield to those that trust in God. That's why the faith is not just any faith. It's not just believing in anything. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So the sort of faith that's going to defend you in this world is when you have faith in God's word, right? So the attacks may be philosophical, you know, for example, like evolution. Evolution is like a philosophical attack. But you must have faith in God's word, saying, you know, God created the world. You know, even though you may not understand all the arguments about evolution, but you have faith, it defends you from being swayed away into false doctrine, and it will lead you to then go study the truth, right? But attacks may be physical as well. You know, sometimes when people go through suffering, they go through hard times, you know, they lose loved ones in their life. You know, people betray them, things like that. Sometimes they take it out on God and they say, I can't believe God would allow that to happen. But if they had the shield of faith, they would know God's word. They would know that that is not the case. You know, sometimes it's even in your own spiritual walk when it's up and down. You know, when you're up and you're living a bit more righteous than normal, feel good. Feel that God loves you. And then you backslide. Feel maybe God doesn't want anything to do with me. Maybe God doesn't love me. Maybe why should I pray? Why should I read my Bible? God doesn't want anything to do with me. But is that right? See, you need the shield of faith. You need to know that God loves you, that God does not forsake you. God has always loved you, even if you don't live the way you ought. So even the shield of faith can prevent emotional darts as well. So you've got physical damage, emotional damage, philosophical as well, just wrong doctrine too. So we need to make sure we have that shield of faith, that we trust what we read in God's word. And take the helmet of salvation. So salvation is likened to a helmet. Why is that? Because it protects our mind, doesn't it? Not only does salvation give us a sound mind, knowing that we are loved by God, it gives us that stability, but also you need to be saved to understand the things of God, right? 2 Timothy 1:7, for God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. You see, so God gives us that sound mind, that stability, because we know we have the love of God, no matter what happens in our life. But 1 Corinthians 2 explains to us that through salvation and receiving the Spirit of God, that's how we understand the things of God. 1 Corinthians 2:12, now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man, so this is the unsaved, unregenerate man, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. So salvation, you can see there, it's a helmet. Why? Because it affects the mind, our understanding of God's truth, our stability, our soundness of mind. You know, making wise the simple, the Bible says. So we see there that helmet of salvation. Now, up until this point, every part in the armor of God is defensive. Now we go on to the offensive tools. What is our offensive weapon? The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. So you see there, it's this spiritual battle. And a spiritual battle requires a spiritual weapon, and that's what the Word of God is. Now, just like with any weapon, you need to practice using that weapon. You need to know your weapon well. You can't just go into a battle and that's the first time you pick up a sword. So what sort of soldier are you going to be if the first time you go into battle, you don't know how to use your weapon? So you need to know your weapon. You need to understand your weapon so that when you go into battle, you are an effective soldier. So it's why you got to come along soul winning. Go along soul winning. That's what you get into the practice of going soul winning, preaching the Bible, preaching the gospel, using the word of God, flipping to different verses in your Bible, so that when you have a conversation with somebody else, you are ready. You've practiced, right? You are used to it. You're experienced. You're not just a newbie, right? John 6:63, it is the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. So we have the offensive weapon. Now we get into other ways we can fight in this battle. Ephesians 6:18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints, and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. So we see here prayer and supplication for yourself, watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplications for all saints. So you see there, it's not just about praying, it's also watching. So what's the idea you get when he's saying watching thereunto? It means you know what's going on, you're not ignorant, right? So yes, you can pray, but pray for things as well that you should be cognizant of. So you're not ignorant of the things that are going on in the world. So you're praying for yourself, watching, and you're praying for others too. Right? So one thing I want to point out here is notice Paul is saying that he should be praying, but then he also says in verse 19, and for me. He wants the Ephesians to pray for him, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. So you see how sometimes people get this idea that, you know, when they want somebody to pray for them, that they get church leaders to pray for them. They feel like, oh, their prayers are like more effective. But look here, Paul, he understands that the prayers of the Ephesians are just as effective as his because he wants them to pray for him. You see there? So prayers by church leaders are effective. Prayers by church members are effective too. So we don't want to get this idea that there's this class system within God's prayer system, that some people's prayers are worth more than others. Yeah, we're praying for one another, then we can help one another, just like Paul prayed for the Ephesians, but he also wanted the Ephesians to pray for him. So we've got to pray for one another. It should not just only be a sort of a one-way thing. Colossians 4:2, continue in prayer and watching the same with thanksgiving, with all praying also for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. You see there, you'd think, I mean, Paul was like the greatest preacher there was. I mean, surely he knew what to say in different situations, and yet he knew his limitations and his capabilities and wanted to be better, right? He wanted so that maybe that through the prayers, like an opportunity would open up that he could not create, right? Or something he would say that he would not otherwise say, to make it known, to make it manifest as I ought to speak. Because just because you have the talents and abilities and you have the knowledge, that doesn't mean in the moment you always do the right thing, you know? And then those of us who go soul winning, we experience it. I mean, I wish knowledge was enough. I wish experience was enough. But sometimes you need God as well, you know, you need God as well to help you in every situation to take that best opportunity when you speak with different people. So we have godly authority, ungodly authority, and we talked about the armor of God, how to resist ungodly authority. Not every person or institution in place is of God, you know, otherwise why would we be resisting some? And the last couple of verses, just a few quick points in Ephesians 6, is God is a personal God. You know, we have this battle in life. You know, we want to live a godly life. But we also have this battle in the world, right? Fighting against spiritual wickedness in high places, rulers of the darkest world, principalities and powers. And I feel like, you know, and God always ends with comfort, but, you know, I think it's good to know that we have a personal God, that God has not left us to fend for ourselves. He's given us a weapon that he has communicated with us. Ephesians 6:21. But that ye also may know my affairs and how I do. Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things, whom I have sent unto you for the same purpose, that ye might know our affairs and that he might comfort your hearts. Now, so when you read this, you may just think, that's just Paul expressing his attitude or his heart to the Ephesians. But you know what I think when I read these things? We see here the heart of God, right? The fact that God is not an impersonal God. He's a personal God. He lets us know. The Bible says we have the mind of Christ. We know what God is thinking because he has given us his word. And that's very different sometimes to the little g gods of this world, right? I mean, think about a lot of New Age philosophy. It's just this spirit or this force that is impersonal. No one really knows what they're thinking. And you have to like meditate. And hopefully you'll know, hopefully you'll get an inkling. And then you don't even know for sure if you got it right. Because some other guy that's just as spiritual as you is telling them something else. Yes? So you see, it's like you just don't know what the will of this unknown force is, right? But that's not God. God has sent people to make known his will to us. And you know, that's something we should really not take for granted. So when we read this, a passage like this, this is like the heart of God saying, hey, that ye also may know my affairs. It's like Jesus, when he was on this earth, he would let his disciples know, hey, this is what's happening. This is why I'm doing it. I want you to know why. It's the same with God. God gives us information. He wants us to know things, right? He wants to know his affairs. And he sends people like prophets preaching God's word to deliver his word. He's not a God afar off, right? He's near to us, right? And he gives us his word, whom I have sent unto you for the same purpose, that you might know our affairs. So you know about God, you know what his plans are, you know what he's thinking, and to the end, why? That it might comfort your hearts. See, in this war we find ourselves in, it can be very disheartening, it can be very discouraging. Life itself can be discouraging. But thankfully, we have God's word. We have truth. So we can have that shield of faith that it will help us, it will encourage us, and it will comfort us. 2 Peter 1. This is a verse here showing that holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Verse 21. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of God, but holy men of God spake as they were moved from the Holy Ghost. So it's God sending people to let us know his will. And not only does Paul sort of end epistles like this, but John also ends epistles like this too. And I think, like I said, when I read these, I don't only think about John expressing it to the people that he's writing to, but it's also God expressing his desire to one day see us. You know, we'll speak face to face. 3 John 13, look at this. I had many things to write, but I will not with ink and pen write unto thee. So, you know, when I read that, I think, you know, it's like God, you know, God had more things that he wanted to tell us, but he withheld it from the Bible. He already gave us so much, but there's more that to find out from God, right? You know, many things to write, but I will not with ink and pen write unto thee, but I trust I shall shortly see thee, and we shall speak face to face. Peace be to thee. Our friends salute thee. Greet thy friends by name. So does not this, you know, maybe you just read this and you just thought, hey, well, John's just looking forward to seeing them again. But when I read this, it's like, hey, God has more things to say, and one day we will see God face to face and we'll be able to speak to him. That's a comforting thing. Ephesians 6:23. Peace be to the brethren and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So I think that is a reference to God and the man Jesus Christ. I don't think that's a reference to the first and second identity within the Trinity. So this is why the Holy Ghost is usually missing in these salutations and whatnot. So that is referring to God, the Spirit, Jesus Christ, the man. And verse 24, grace be with all them that love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. Now this verse here is sometimes used to teach work salvation. But, you know, grace is more than salvation. You know, grace from God. We ask for God's grace just to live our life. So, yes, I think there is additional grace given to those that love the Lord Jesus Christ. What's that? Sincerely, in sincerity. They truly do. Amen. All right, so in conclusion, respect and obey the godly authority that God has set up. Right? But be a godly leader if you find yourself in that situation. 2, resist ungodly authority. We need to put on the armor of God. You know, remember, you can put on the armor of God in different degrees. Hey, having done all to stand. Right? And then we take comfort that we don't serve in ignorance. We don't serve an impersonal God. We serve a personal God, you know, that desires to know us, and one day we'll see him face to face. All right, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for, you know, these twin epistles, Colossians and Ephesians. So much practical knowledge, so much doctrine as well. So Lord, you know, help us to fight this spiritual fight. Help us to put on the armor of God. And Lord, let's be offensive in our Christianity, not just defensive. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.